So you have a different type of dating methods. You have a different type of dating methods, like you have a relative dating method, and as well as you have a absolute dating method. Okay, what is the difference between the relative and absolute dating method? A relative dating method is based on the relativeness of the strata. Okay, very simple. The relative dating is nothing but on the basis of relative relativeness of the data, whereas your absolute dating method will give you the pinpoint age, giving you the pinpoint age of the any strata. Like I want to give you the example for the this two dating method. Okay. I would like to use the whiteboard. Where is whiteboard? Here. So here you have a whiteboard. So there is a two type of dating method. Okay, there is a two type of dating method. One is relative. One is relative dating method. And other one is absolute. Now I am explaining you what is the difference between this relative and absolute dating methods. What is the difference between the absolute and discerning method? So relative dating method is just like when you are in a class. For example, Kritika, Rahul, Dipanshu, Taki, and Nachiket, all are you in the class, sitting in the MSc class. Okay, so you have a different student like Abhijit, okay, Abhijit, Kunal, Saili, Shetakshi, Shashwati, Abhishek, and Shubham, and all. And you are also the part of that same classroom. So by seeing you and by seeing the your date of birth or other whatever the other documents, or without other documents, on the basis of your height and your look, how you look like, I can easily say that yes, Kritika is a youngest one in the classroom. This person is older than the Kritika. The Abhijit is looks like 3 to 4 years more older than the Rahul. So how I can see? On the basis of the primary inferences, how they are looks like, how they are looks like, on the basis of primary inferences, I will I can say like this, that this is a younger one, this is an older one, on the basis of only how we can, I can say them, see them on a primary basis. What is the absolute? So this is the best example for relative dating. So how I can recognize the age of your all the student on the primary inferences, how your looks like? So that in the geology also, you have a relative dating method. Means here the criteria is different. Here is the criteria is different. But you can give the age that yes, this rock is older than this one. Like you have, for example, you have this sedimentation. Okay, this is the A. This is the A unit. This is the B unit. This is A unit. This is a B unit. So this is a A and B. Okay, this is a A and B unit. This is a A and B. So A, on the basis of sedimentation history, on the basis of sedimentation history, we can suggest that A is older than the B, because A is deposited first. We are talking about the undisturbed strata. In undisturbed strata, your A is always older than your B. So B is younger. Okay. O is older. A is older than B. So B is more younger than the your A formation. Okay. So this is the two different type of strata we have. And on the basis of their relativeness, how they are deposited, we can suggest that this is a relativeness of the two different dating method. Okay, so this is how the relative dating and absolute dating method can be applied. Then this is about the relative dating, whatever I explain you. Now what is the absolute dating? Absolute dating is when you have pinpoint, when you pinpoint the age of anyone. Like me, I have the birth certificate of Pritika, Rahul, and this one. So if I have the birth certificate of yourself, I can say that the age of the Pritika is 17 years 3 months and some days. The age of the Rahul is 18 years 2 months and something days. So if I want, if I know the exact age, if I have the birth certificate of yourself, I can pinpoint the exact age. When I have the birth certificate. In the geological time also, in geological case also, what happened? You have a exact age of that particular rocks. Radiocarbon dating and other dating method we apply. So you have a specific age. On the basis of that age, you can know that what is the age of that rock. What is the age of absolute age of that rock? This is how we can study the relative and absolute age method. Okay. So now we come back to the dating method, that is the radiocarbon dating. Now today we are going to deal only with the radiocarbon dating method. I am just giving you the background how the dating method is applied and what is the different kind of method, like you have absolute and relative dating method. So you have a different kind of elements. Like hydrogen, helium, neon, argon, and this all. Okay, so this is a different kind of elements you have. The most of the elements is having their isotope. So what is the theory of isotope? So you always seen in the periodic table that there is a atomic mass number, okay, atomic number and atomic mass number. Okay, so atomic number is nothing but the a number of proton. So if there is a C6, that is carbon 6, it means that you have a number of proton in carbon is 6. 6 is the number of proton in your carbon. That is how it is called as a C6. Then you have number of proton equal the number of electron. Okay. So you have a symbol of C. Okay. Carbon name and this one all. So the number of electron determine how the element react chemically. Number of electron determine the how the element react chemically. So isotope of carbon is C12. So there is a number of isotope for the carbon. There is a number of isotope for the carbon. Like you have a C12, which is known as the 6 proton and 6 neutron. Okay. Have a C13, that is a 6 proton and 7 neutron, and C14, that is a 6 proton and 8 neutron. So this is a different kind of element we have. Okay. So you have a this stable isotope. So you have a different kind of isotope which continuously decay. So isotope is nothing but a two type of isotope. One is stable, one is unstable. One is stable, one is unstable. So which one is a stable isotope? C12, C13 is a stable isotope. C12 and C13 is a stable isotope, whereas C14-6 is a unstable one. It continuously get decay into the nitrogen, then nitrogen get decay into the carbon. So radioactive, so the decay of the radioactive element follow the logarithmic curve. The more atom you have, the more atom decay each unit of time. The fewer atom you have, the fewer atom decay each unit of time. In fact, the number of atom that decay is equal to constant time of number of atom in your sample. So you can have a starting the activity, you can have a starting the activity from here. Then if you have 2 gram of the carbon, then it is converted to the nitrogen. The carbon is converted to the nitrogen. So 2 gram of carbon when converted to the 2 gram of the carbon is converted to the 1 gram of the carbon. This is activity, this is known as the what? This is known as the your one half-life. This is known as the one half-life. So radioactive decay is known as the one half-life. Then the 1 gram is again converted to the half gram. 1 gram is again converted to the half gram. This is known as the second half-life. Then that 1 gram is again half gram is again converted to the 0.25 gram. Half gram is again converted to the 0.25 gram. This is known as the third half-life. So this is a first, second and third means whatever your material is there, they are continuous. Okay. So you can have 2 gram. From 2 gram, it is converted to the 1 gram. From 1 gram, it is converted to the half gram. And from half gram, it is converted to the 0.25 gram, like this. Okay. So different kind of operation can take place on this one. Okay. So the curve continue in the same shape. The curve is continue in the same shape, decreasing by half life every half life, no matter where or when you start. So this curve is showing that where you have exactly. Okay, where you have exactly. So if your material is not converted to the 1 gram, if it is a 1.27 gram also, you can calculate the age accordingly. So because you know that 2 gram of the sample converted to the 1 gram of the sample, how much time is required actually, that you know. If you can measure the change in the activity, you can determine the time interval between the measurement. If you can measure the change in the activity, you can determine the time interval between the measurement. We need to know the starting activity. We need to know the starting activity. If I measure the activity at one time and then measure it again later and find that it is a 1/5 the previous activity, then so you can using some mathematical calculation, you can easily get, you can easily have this all the operations. Then you have activity of, then you have activity like disintegration per second. Then you have activity like disintegration per second. So one curie equal to 3.7 into 10 to the power 10 dBs. That is the decay of 1 gram radium 226. One curie. So this is the temperature is also depending upon the, so your activity is also depending upon the temperature. So you have many atoms of carbon, okay, many atoms of carbon. So each atom of carbon weight is 12.0107 Dalton or AMU on the average. This would contain about 6.022. So carbon is having a more atoms, C6, 6, 12, 13, 14. So now it would all decay to nitrogen 14 in less than 1 million years. So where does carbon 14 come from? So carbon and your nitrogen is exchanged with each other. Carbon and nitrogen get exchanged with each other. So cosmic ray enter the atmosphere causing the molecule to fly apart. Cosmic ray enter the atmosphere causing molecule to fly apart. The resulting neutron collide into the N14 atoms. N14 atom convert into the C14 atoms. Okay. So cosmic ray enter the atmosphere causing the molecule to fly apart. The resulting neutron collide into N14 atom. So when you have in the atmosphere, you have a nitrogen, know that the more than 70% is your nitrogen in your atmosphere. So that that nitrogen get collide with the collide with the cosmic ray. So the resulting neutron collide into the N14 atoms. N14 atom convert into the C14 atom. So you have a N7 to 14, which is converted to the C6 to 14. You have a N7 to 14, which is converted to the C6 to 14. So you are T1/2 is 5730 years. That is your half life age of this world. Then you have how your nitrogen get converted to the your carbon by the this equation. This is the equation how your carbon 14 can form. Again, carbon 14 is get converted to the nitrogen 14 by the beta decay. So when you take neutron from this one, okay, one electron from this one, you can number will be increased by one. So like this one, you have a nitrogen 14/7. Okay, that is the 7 is the atomic number. So when you have this, so this equation will give you the carbon 14. This is a cycle. This is a continuously cycle. So your carbon 14 is unstable. So carbon 14 is also unstable. So this is how your cycle is going to rotate and proceed. Then you have equilibrium. If the horse adds water at a constant rate of 10 gallon per minute, then the amount of water in the barrel will be rise until it reaches point where 10 gallons per minute leaks out. Okay, so what is the equilibrium? What is the equilibrium means? If you have a one beaker, what is the equilibrium? I will explain you what is mean by equilibrium exactly. And in that beaker, you are throwing the water by some of the speed. That speed is water is using the we use the water the unit for the water is a gallon. If you release the water 10 gallons. This 10 gallons per minute is the rate of what you input to this beaker, and same way you can take away the water by some flush and something like that from the bottom at the same speed, that is the 10 gallons per meter per minute. So until the speed of the water which is coming into your beaker is increased or fluctuate, your beaker don't get leaked or water cannot get out of this one. It remain a constant. So this is the principle of equilibrium. If the hose add more and less water per minute, the amount of water in the barrel will be increased or decreased until the amount leaving in the barrel once again the equal the amount of entering the barrel. So you have a cosmic ray, which produce about 8 kilogram of C14 per year. The cosmic ray produces about 8 kilograms of C14 per year. This rate is assumed to be a constant for a past few million years. If the 50% of the C14 decay in 5370 years, then 0.013 of C14 decay per year. When the amount of C14 reaches 62,000 kg, then the 8 kg will be decay per year. So this is a simple operation and which will explain the carbon-14 concepts. So cosmic ray produce about 8 kilograms of the C14 per year. Cosmic ray produce about 8 kilograms of C14 per year. So this rate is assumed to be constant for the past few million years. If the 50% of the carbon-14 decay in 5370 years, then 0.013 of C14 decay per unit. When the amount of C14 reaches 62,000 kg, then 8 kg will be decay per year. So this is how the operation of this carbon-14 is going on. So you can see that this is a picture which is very colorful, that carbon-14 is produced by the cosmic ray from the nitrogen in the upper atmosphere. Okay, in the upper atmosphere you have this carbon-14. So carbon-14 then combine with the oxygen. To form a carbon dioxide. Plant and use this carbon dioxide in a photosynthesis to form a glucose. Carbon-14 enter the food chain as the animal eat then plants. So this is how you can have this different kind of definitely your plants and animal can take this carbon-14 in this one and they are form the glucose. Okay, so plant form the glucose by the photosynthesis, and the grass and all this one is taken by your animal. So 62,000 kg of the carbon-14 in a 75 n number of zero is there, kgs of carbon is the biosphere. So one Olympic size pool 24 times. So this is how that they are scaling this one carbon 14. So in geological time scale, carbon 14 with the half life of 5,730 years only can be used to date back the 50,000 to 75,000 years. What is the how long our Earth history is? Our Earth history is 5,730 years, means you have you can go up to the 9 to 10 cycle only. You can go up to the 9 to 10 cycle only. So your Earth age of your Earth is 4.6 billion years. So where is the billion and where is the million and where is the thousand? So there is a so much difference in this one, so that you can use the this carbon radiocarbon dating method only for the 50,000. So this cover a very small time scale, your recent time scale. This cover very small and recent time scale of all. So then why we are using this one? So if it is not covered a very long time frame, why we are all using this one? We use this one for the carbon 14 because the carbon 14 is get give you the very absolute ages. Very absolute ages. What it means by absolute ages? The error. The error is equally a very less in the radiocarbon date. You can see that the more archaeologists, and all uses the this radiocarbon dating. So this is how you can use the radiocarbon dating for the purpose of dating. So then you have this is what you have a different kind of mechanism which is involved in this one. So now how you can measure the carbon isotope? So you use the AMS dating, AMS method, that is a accelerated mass spectrometry. So you can have the sample. When you have a sample, you can analyze them. So this is a composition of atmosphere. In atmosphere, you have 78% of the nitrogen, 21% of the oxygen, and 0.34% of the argon. So this is a different kind of things you have. About one in every a trillion molecule of the carbon dioxide contain a carbon 14. That's a 1 is equal to 1 trillion year. Okay. Therefore, about 1 out of every trillion molecule of CO2 which plant take in a build sugar and structural composition contain the C14. So C14 is very less in nature. Therefore, about 1 out of every trillion molecule of carbon in the plants that animal eat is C14. Therefore, about 1 out of every trillion molecule of carbon in animal is C14. So what if there was more CO2 in the ancient atmosphere to mix the carbon 14 with? So this is our assumption that the carbon is constant throughout this time. So most scientists agree that CO2 level have changed over time. They think the CO2 level were half of the today value 10,000 years ago, but that's not what we can reflect in the carbon 14 dating. This is a different kind of issues with the carbon 14 dating, but all, with all this limitation and all, the carbon 14 dating is a very useful and handy one. So in this figure, what we can see, the one complete this one. The planet turns CO2 into the organic molecule. Plants and animal release the CO2 as they convert sugar to energy. Then you have decomposition of plants and animal release CO2 back into atmosphere. Burning of plants or fossil you are release CO2 back into the atmosphere. So the carbon fixed by the plant return to the air as a CO2 by respiration in plant and animal and by the decomposition of dead plant and animal. A large part of the C14 in the atmosphere is the which in contain the plant and animal bodies. So this is a part of the equilibrium system. So 29 trillion metric ton of carbon in the biosphere today, 6,820 trillion metric ton of carbon buried as a coal and oil till now, 20,000 trillion metric tons of the carbon buried in the geological column as the calcium carbonate. All this buried carbon comes from the atmosphere. The amount of carbon 14 in the today's atmosphere is not used to be a starting point for the carbon analysis. Today, atmospheric content from the industry, carbon dioxide industry. So now we can see the what this is a some of the problem is associated with. Problem is associated with the radiocarbon dating. So machine background without a sample. So when you because this your hair and all this one is a part of organic material. So if there is any contamination are there, if any contamination are there, your all the this technique your all the dating will be get hampered. Your all the dating get hampered. So what you can do, you can have a machine, you can have the a blank sample. Can have the blank sample in the your machines. Okay, so you have if that will give the sum of the reading. If that will give the sum of the reading, so means that you can have the. Some of the impurities in your sample. Why is there so much radiocarbon? So you have anthracite coal, you have fossilized wood, natural gas, shale, graphite, petroleum, whalebone. This is what material you can use for the radiocarbon dating. Cosmic ray are high speed particle from the high energy resources in our galaxy. So you have a 90% of the proton in this one, 9% of the alpha particle, 1% is the other heavier nuclei. So this is a different kind of things you have. So scientists believe that Earth magnetic field has varied from the half to the 2 times that present value in the past 6,000 years. This would affect how much cosmic radiation strike the atmosphere and how much carbon is produced. So if a C14 date support our theories we put in the main text, if it does not entirely constrain them, we put it in the footnote and it is a completely out of date, we just drop it. So till now whatever the dating method you are using is on the principle of 5,700 age of the. This is the exact age of the how the your C14 is get converted to the nitrogen 14. this is how the what is the exact age of the you can convert this C 14 to the nitrogen 14. And when you have this nitrogen 14 and C 14, so you can have the this you can have the a minimum time frame is you know that what is the exact time frame is required to convert this carbon 14 into the nitrogen 14. So this is what about so what is the application of this radiocarbon dating. Now we are going to see the what is the application of this radiocarbon dating. So application is if you the recent history is very much important. Recent history is very much important for the mankind. So the application of this radiocarbon is very vast. So the most of the application is also in geology, but archaeology people is more use this one. The archaeology people is more used one because they know about the Bronze Age and all this one. So exactly the what happened that what is the age of this one is they are going to this application. What is the age? So this is all about most of the things about the radiocarbon dating. But just the application part is missing. So application is that like you have some of the now some of the ages you don't know about the material of this material. What is the age of this material? Okay, if you are in archaeological site, but what is the age of this material? Whether it is belonging to Bronze Age, whether it is belonging to Bronze Age, so it get a Bronze Age. So if you have this all, if you have this technique, the radiocarbon technique with you, you can have the a good and better idea about the how the radiocarbon technique can be used. So AMS technique, that is a accelerated mass spectroscopy is used. You can put the sample there, you can have some readings. Okay, after putting the sample you can have some readings, and that reading you can use for the purpose of to know the age of the that sequence, to know the age of that any drop. So this is all about the radiocarbon technique and all. So thank you for listening this one.